that I just stuck around and graduated. Don't take my model. I can't tell you how much it means to me to be back here as your speaker. I give many talks around the country, but mostly they're about journalism, the threats against it, how important it is to society. What I rarely do is reflect on my own life. It feels narcissistic to me. I think journalists choose the profession because it allows them to examine others, to question the powerful, to criticize society. We don't much like to think about our own lives. We are not what you would call self-reflective. So thinking of what to say to you was actually quite hard. It meant digging back in time and thinking about my own life, searching for any lessons, any guidance I could give people who are about to embark on their own adventures, who will have families, struggle through wildly successful and occasionally unsatisfying careers. And as I thought through it all, I realized there might be some lessons embedded in my life. The word aimless does not quite capture the 17-year-old kid who left New Orleans 42 years ago for Morningside Heights. Maybe aimless and scared work best in combination. I grew up in a household with no books, to parents who did not graduate from high school. I'd never been on an airplane. I had spent my whole life in working class, old black neighborhoods, where the only white people around me were nuns and priests. I thought of them as the other, in that they had no race, no history, no real background that I knew of or cared about. I actually had no luggage, though I had a lot of baggage. And I had not even owned an overcoat when I accepted a scholarship to Columbia. I had only applied because a close friend of mine had always wanted to go there, and he wanted company. I had barely heard of Columbia. Unfortunately, I got in, and he did not. And that was tragic. He got in later on. I grew up in a neighborhood called Treme, famous then and now for its jazz musicians, public dancing, and crime rate. I don't ever recall being outside of Treme, except for the times my father drove to French Quarter to buy cigarettes for the vending machine in the bar he owned. My New Orleans, much like the New Orleans of today, much like most big American cities, was segregated by race and economics. It is odd that I became executive editor of the New York Times, given that as a kid I never heard of the New York Times. Unlike most of the people I work with today, who seem to have built their lives around a desire to work for what was then and still is the world's greatest newspaper. One of the themes of my editorship of the New York Times, by the way, is that I want to make sure it doesn't become so expensive and so exclusive that it turns off people like the kid I was. I had a father who wanted desperately for us to succeed, and he was a constant and forceful presence. I don't recall feeling this at the time, but his insistence that we mop the bar before school every day instilled in me the foundation of a work ethic. It has taken me years and reading much literature, poetry, and history to understand that his anger and exhaustion came from growing up in the segregated South with the limitations that had been forced on his own ambitions. A side lesson, if you'll indulge me. Your parents may actually be better than you think they are. Just take a bit of time to see the world through their eyes, and trust me, it's worth the exercise. My father could be hard to live with sometimes, but he gave us a sense that we could succeed. Though what success meant in a world that seemed relatively small was elusive. Somewhere in there, I picked up a relentless ambition that has pushed me, sometimes pained me to this day. I will talk later about that ambition and the importance of tempering it. Here's a memory from my first exposure to politicians. one that, that I realized affected me a great deal, since I've now spent most of my life either covering politicians or directing coverage of them, from George Bush the first to Donald Trump the first. My first exposure to Louisiana politicians was the day Governor John McKiffin, well into his second term, came to our new gymnasium at St. Augustine High School in New Orleans. There was a sense that this was a big deal, a governor making his way to our little school to talk to us as future leaders. And I have a vague recollection that McKiffin was regarded by Southern standards as relatively progressive. But I remember most, but what I remember most is that his deep, deep Louisiana accent caused him to mangle the word Negro in an embarrassing way that left all 700 of us feeling humiliated and angry, and a little sad that we couldn't do anything about it. We were called together the next day and told that it was a mispronunciation. I'm not sure I believe it. That was the scared kid who showed up at Columbia, a little baffled that you could fit a whole school in such a tight space, and that the greenery around College Walk was not nearly as huge as the recruiting catalogs made it appear. My college grades were not particularly great, but something happened to me at Columbia that I'm not even sure I understood at the time. Quietly, slowly, my world expanded. The exposure to different people, the understanding that the world was wider, that there was art, and that most of your education took place not in the classroom. I think it was at Columbia that I learned two valuable lessons that have stayed with me, and I'd like to stay with you. Listen, and listen hard. And while you shouldn't question your own ethics, you should question your own certainty about everything else. This is the advice part of the speech, if you'll forgive me. What I learned at Columbia and after. I hope you hear at least part of it, you grapple with it in your own lives, because I have no doubt, despite my warning about certainty, that's the truth. Don't let ambition blind you. Don't have your eyes so focused on the goal, whether it be money or rank or some other measure of success, that you fail to enjoy the journey, the getting there. Don't be so ambitious for one thing that you fail to see when something better comes along, something more fulfilling, something that serves your soul more powerfully. And don't let ambition warp your sense of self or force you to compromise your principles. Pay attention when others, your family, your colleagues, everyone you encounter, pay attention when they say that your ambition or your drive is causing them pain, because they're probably right. I vaguely thought I wanted to be a lawyer or maybe a professor. Then I walked into the newsroom for the first time. I just wanted a job, but I found a calling. It was a hot day in New Orleans. I heard the clattering of typewriters. You can see them in a museum sometime. I saw people rushing around on deadline. I saw people hunched over their desks with half-eaten sandwiches, doing interviews over the phone, shouting at each other on deadline, and I fell in love. Suddenly, this young man who was a little listless, with scattered but intense reading habits, getting B's and C's, was working long hours, not even putting in for overtime. I did the grunt work between fires and murders. The first time I saw a bloated dead body pulled out of the Mississippi River, I turned away and threw up while the cops laughed at me. I listened as mothers told the stories of the lives of sons who had been killed or had killed. And I came to understand that literally everyone has a story if you just shut up and listen. Remember what I said about enjoying the journey? Looking back, someone told me that I should never be a journalist because I would end up covering cops and courts, and wouldn't that be awful? Truth be told, covering cops and courts was the absolute most fun I've ever had in my professional life. During those months, I grabbed hold of everyone who could teach me anything, and I forced myself on them. One reporter who was ignored by all of his colleagues because he was a little eccentric. taught me that if you smile and show some humility, people will invite you into their houses and tell you their stories. They just want to tell them to someone who will honestly listen and won't greedily exploit their tragedy. When I ran out of teachers, I grabbed better newspapers from the library and deconstructed the way stories were put together until I could do it myself. I learned fairness by being totally unfair. One day while covering a rape trial, I wrote a hyped and exaggerated story about the defendant just so I could make the front page. I was shameless, overeager, too ambitious, and I was proud of myself. Front page stories were hard to come by for a beginning reporter who was now all of 20 years old. I was pleased with myself. That is, until I walked into court the next day and was confronted by the defendant, an indignant man who deserved a lot better than an ambitious careerist trying to make a name for himself. He glowered at me the whole day until I shrank in the back of the courtroom. Then his lawyer chewed me out, and I learned a valuable lesson about fairness, one that I've never forgotten. I had misdirected my ambition and abused my power, meager as it was, and never did it again. I had a friend and colleague who was truly an empathetic person. He and I once went to the home of the mother of a crime victim, desperate for an interview. Ambitiously, I rushed toward the door, the hunt for a good quote practically dripping from me. He walked in, listening, shuffling slightly, wanting to hear their story. She talked to him. She barely noticed me. In the years since, I've worked for 5 newspapers, counting 2 times at the New York Times. I've stumbled almost literally into a profession that has taken me around the world, that has let me ask tough questions of the most powerful people in the world, but has also left me mumbling incoherently through a lunch with Gabriel Garcia Marquez. I've had a blast, and no one believes this, but I've never thought for one second about the end game. I never fantasized about being editor of the New Orleans Times-Picayune, let alone the New York Times. I had a blast with the doing. In fact, I've always had suspicions about colleagues who seem overly ambitious, who seem driven by something else. There's, of course, a contradiction here. Of course I was ambitious. But maybe my upbringing left me able to enjoy the doing without expectations for something too great. One newspaper story about sticking to your principles. When I was managing editor of the Los Angeles Times, shortly after 9/11, my phone rang early one morning as I had coffee in my house in Santa Monica. On the line, to my surprise, was George Tenet, then the director of the Central Intelligence Agency. Tenet is a gruff but charming man. We made small talk. I told him I was planning on taking my son to an afternoon movie, and I couldn't make up my mind between a family film and a war movie. He recommended a war movie. Boys like that kind of stuff, Tenet said, summoning, I suppose, years of intelligence experience. Then he got to the point. The LA Times was about to publish a fairly explosive story about how the CIA was spying on the Iranian community in the US as a way to learn more about Iran, where it had precious few spies. This story, Tenet insisted, seriously, would endanger lives. It would hurt an ongoing intelligence operation. Then, he added darkly, it would hurt the war on terrorism. I told him you have to be more specific, that my job is to publish stories, not to kill them. He couldn't tell me more, just that it would hurt the war on terrorism and I should be a patriot. I agreed to hold the story for one day, so I could at least have another look at it and talk to the writer. Then I took my son to see the family movie. I thought about it hard, but I thought that my principle, that the world had the right to know how the government spies on it, trumped Tenet's principle. The next day I called Tenet at home, told him I hadn't heard enough of a reason to hold the story, that we were publishing it the next day on the front page on a banner headline, which we did. The day of publication, I waited for the world to cave in, for for the government to denounce us, at least for Bill O'Reilly to call me unpatriotic. I was disappointed. Nothing happened, not a thing. To put it mildly, the head of the CIA had exaggerated, to say the least. Here's how editors have fun. I walked into the newsroom the next day after publication and watched as every other newspaper in America picked up our story, giving us credit. Actually, I shredded through the newsroom that day, taking calls here and there from editors at competing papers. Editors have fun vicariously. I'd like to thank you for the chance to speak to you today. If you keep your ambition in check and enjoy the doing and not just the getting there, you will have a better time in whatever you do. You should listen and never assume you're right. You've given me a chance to honor a school that has given me the courage and confidence to get to places I would never have gone, and to remind myself just how much fun I've had along the way. And I thank you sincerely.